This is George Cholas from AGORACOM for AGORACOM TV, talking to you live from the Cambridge Conference floor in Toronto at the Metro Convention Center. I've got with me John Kaiser of Kaiser Bottom Fish Online. John, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
The big buzz around the show has been your views on rare metals lately, which have really taken off with investors. What we're all trying to find out here, is this just another commodity rush that's taking place with other, like other metals in the past, uranium and moly and things like that, or is rare metals here to stay? How do you feel about rare metals?
Well, with rare earths in particular, the situation is 95% of it comes from China, as for the last 20 years. There are a lot of deposits, well, not a lot, there are a couple dozen significant deposits outside of China, which were not economic. But what's happened is these major new plans, such as China going electric car direct, skipping gasoline cars entirely, and building huge wind farms, and say in North America and Europe, this idea that yes, green technology, we want a lot of our energy to be not carbon dioxide producing. This is creating a potential major demand for hybrid cars and other technologies that use these rare earths. So the existing supply structure is not adequate to meet future demand. There's no shortage in these metals right now. These metals are not going to the moon. The problem will exist 4 to 6 years from now. Now, the Chinese have put us on notice by saying, we need this for our really long-term plans. You guys, if you want any of this stuff, build your manufacturing facilities in our country and export the goods, which, of course, the Japanese, Europeans, and Americans don't particularly want to do, especially with these high-end goods. And so the Japanese now, for a couple of years, have been scouring the planet trying to get a fix on where to get these critical ingredients for which there's no substitute that are essential to commercializing these long-term plans. And the obvious solution that's starting to emerge right now is put these deposits outside of China into production. And the Chinese have basically said, yes, you need to do this unless you want to build all your stuff here. It's not any sort of trade war thing or anything like that. The demand for these products is going to go from $1 billion to $2 billion that they are right now to $10 to $20 billion in a year, 10 years or so from now. But not if the solution is not achieved and plans are put in place now to put these deposits into production. And these stocks have rocketed because there's been an awakening in the mainstream media about the rare earth problem. And we who are at these conferences and know all about these juniors have realized the only solution to this are these juniors which happen to own these deposits. And the realization that it's not economic logic that's going to drive the buyout and the development plans, but strategic logic driven by long-term thinking about, if I don't have the rare earths needed for the neo magnets in my hybrid, I can't sell millions of cars over the next 10 years. And I believe we are facing a 10-year transition to hybrid cars, followed by a shift to complete electric cars. And without these rare earth deposits going into production around the world, this is not going to happen. So I think everybody, all the stars are lined up to be behind this happening. I suspect we'll see the end users come in, pay a strategic premium to own these deposits, and then they'll just disappear from view. It is going to be a short mania because all the main contenders are going to be absorbed, privatized, very good premiums, even based on the values that we see now. And then there'll be a big expiration boom. We're looking for other major ones, just as we saw with diamonds in the late 90s after the big candy discovery.
Now let's talk a little bit about what investors should be looking for, because unfortunately one thing about this industry you and I don't know too well is you're going to have a couple of dozen companies pop up and claim to be these rare earth kind of companies. What should investors be looking for in order to be able to really differentiate the real companies from those that are going to just try and capitalize on a market boom but don't really have the goods? What are the two or three things that you look for that investors should be looking for?
Well, the first thing is the system has to be launched. You have to have a lot of tons of this stuff because the buyers for this are going to be looking for something that can produce 20 to 50 years. So showing or a little channel sample isn't going to do it. This is why these deposits found in the 60s, 70s, and 80s by Unocal, Hecla, Iron Ore Company, and then abandoned because the market disappear for these things because of the Chinese production. These things are big systems which need a metallurgical problem solved. And that's a big thing too, the metallurgy. Now you'll hear a lot of negative stuff, oh, that one doesn't have a process, or that one you can't crack the minerals. That's actually not true. Everything has a process, it's just a question of cost. Can you put together a process which will take out all those target rare earth minerals at a cost close to what these are worth? Because again, this is not a game about net present value. At the moment, these things all have zero or marginal net present value.
Interesting point. Okay,
it's
that's
the,
very interesting.
The downstream value. And it can become a potential mania because you can't quantify the value of all the alloys, special materials, and applications that you can make with these things if you control them. So it isn't just the $1 billion that this is all about. It's about many, many more $1 billion worth of value. And of course, look at the rock value. This is the reason people have had a problem getting their heads around this. You've got to look at the individual grades of each of these rare earth elements and then multiply that by the price for that rare earth element and add it all up to get a rock value. That requires using a spreadsheet, literally an Excel spreadsheet. You cannot do it on the back of a napkin. And if you get a high rock value and you can map that to a decent tonnage footprint, well, then you know you've got something worth sinking several tens of millions of dollars into to properly delineate the 43-101 resource and throw the dough at the R&D for cracking the metallurgical problem.